I got your own pepper right here.
How much money did you just save when you go to the grocery store?
Easily 50 cents. I'm Dusty Slay, and I'm a stand-up comedian.
How many people thought my hair was attached to this hat?
And my favorite thing is gardening.
What is that?
That's a pepper plant that didn't do well. Not that I'm any good at it. If I had to survive off the food I grew this year, I would be dead. We're gonna talk to some experts today about gardening, grounding, and homesteading. And I brought my friend Steve here along to check out the garden.
When Dusty first told me he was into gardening, I thought, how quick can I hang up and delete his number from my cell phone?
Let's get into it. Every beautiful thing that you see out here has been done by me.
This is a gardening show and you have one plant.
Well, this is a, well, listen, this is November.
It's, you don't have anything to show me.
I'm getting to it.
Well,
got this
it.
is edible right now.
What is that?
Collards.
I just eat it?
You can eat that right now.
Didn't even wash his hands. Didn't even wash it to think, hey, it's my guest. No, fuck it.
No need to wash it when it's organic. There's no pesticides on this.
It's great, buddy.
I think it's pretty clear at this point that I won't be living off my land and what I'm growing anytime soon. But Shaye Elliott of the Elliott Homestead does live off the land. And so I'd like to go talk to her now and see if she can help me out. Thank you for joining me here. It's so exciting. I appreciate you coming on here and it's great to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you too. And you're welcome.
So just for people listening, how would you describe what a homestead is?
A homestead is really anything where you're kind of focused on being a producer of something and not just consumer. So like we bought our dairy cow off Craigslist, like responsible people. We had an hour to get to know her and then we had to get up underneath this 1,000-pound cow that had no idea who we were and try to milk her. Have you ever milked a cow by hand?
I have not milked a cow, no.
Well, it's an experience. And you realize like we either have to jump in the deep end of this thing or we're gonna sink. Like this cow's, the cow will get mastitis if we don't milk it. And I think that that kind of attitude really unites homesteaders. I wanna produce something and I'm gonna figure it out.
Steve, have you ever hunted an animal, milked a cow, or killed your own food?
No, I've not killed anything other than my career by appearing here today on your show.
My grandfather was born in 1900 in Alabama, and he plowed a field with a mule and a hand plow. And then here we are 120 years later, and I just do comedy for a living. And I feel so disconnected from the food that I eat.
How often do we just shovel food in our mouths, or we, you know, go out, we have drinks with friends, we do whatever, and we don't even really think about what we're doing. And when you're eating food that you grow, you don't, that's not an option. Like, you have to think about it.
And I made my pizza with the fresh vegetables from my garden.
I called Domino's. They brought it within 30 minutes, and I watched a ball game. It was the fucking greatest.
But when you eat your own fresh vegetables, your body says, hey, you have energy. Let's live our lives.
I'd rather live to 60 and die early by eating like an eighth grader than being healthy.
Is there something funny or gross or something that you didn't realize about homesteading that really sticks out to you that you discovered once you were into it?
Having a milk cow is really, it is a steep learning curve. Any woman who's had mastitis knows how painful it is. It's just equally as painful for a cow. But the disgusting thing is you still have to get the milk out. That's the only way to get the mastitis to go away. So when you squirt milk out from a cow that has mastitis, imagine like a latex glove, you know, like your dentist wears, with a little small hole in one of the fingers. Now imagine that glove is filled with cottage cheese. And your job is to squeeze all the cottage cheese out through that little hole in that one fingertip. It's the grossest thing.
Yeah, it is.
Let's see what we got here.
Oh no. There is no real ginger root here.
This show should be called Come Back Next Week. That's what it should be called. I'm gonna have, I used to have, I should have. Come back next week, Steve.
Oh, look, jalapenos.
There we go, that's good. Are you gonna bite that on camera? Are these hot?
Let's see. It's not so bad.
Let me have a hit of that, because I like peppers.
Yeah.
I don't give a shit. Buddy, what are you talking about?
Has that got a lot of spice?
Holy fuck. That's really hot, dude.
It does got a bit. It does got a bit of spice to it as you get on up in there.
Holy shit, dude.
Are you okay? Do you need something?
A newspaper and a toilet that your wife isn't going to use.
It seems like it's really changed the mood of the day.
It changed everything, Dusty.
Let's take a break from being outside in the garden and step inside to chat with...
Hey, she led a garden.
I do comedy, you do comedy, and now we're both gardening. So that's very exciting. So I always tell people that it's kind of like growing a garden is like a slow social media dopamine hit. When the seed starts to sprout, you're like, yes. And it is the same as getting likes, except it's harder.
It is a lot harder. It is a lot harder, and you have to have a lot more patience, but it's so much more rewarding at the end of the day. Just like, I guess, with a kid, you know, okay, I need to feed this baby 3 times a day or 4 or 5 times when they're brand new. I need to change this, do that, like, you know, keep it clean. I would also suggest, like, before you plant anything, what I like to do before I plant anything is baking soda is my friend.
Okay.
So I... treat my earth first with some, I put down baking soda for like maybe a week or so before, like treat, like it, cause it kills bacteria and stuff. And plants get infections just like we can get infections, right? I don't think they get like gonorrhea or anything, but they definitely can get.
That's a wild plant.
That's one of them passion fruits.
Man, without the dressing, a salad is just fucking awful.
What's the best thing you've grown? Like that made you the most happy?
Everything I grow makes me really happy. I grew some okra. Oh, it was so delicious.
Yeah.
I grew some artichokes. I got a whole bunch of jalapenos that I grew. I'm very proud of my jalapenos. I pickle them. Mwah! Delicious. Oh, I'm super proud of my bell peppers.
Oh, yeah. I grew so many bell peppers. So I love that. When you grow a bell pepper, you can really eat it right off the tree and it tastes delicious.
Delicious.
What about a failure? What's something you wanted to grow but weren't able to grow?
I wanted to grow one of them bonsai trees.
Oh, yeah.
Never works for me.
The one thing I tried to grow was bonsai trees. I spent, you know, $50, $60 on like 5 or 6 different bonsai trees. I did the more difficult thing in gardening, which is I killed them.
Here's a question, and I don't know if they're, yes, I say, how does your gardening connect to your life as a comedian?
I run a lot of my jokes on my garden. I like to call it plant-based comedy.
Yeah. I've been so excited about these carrots. Wait till you see this. There it is. That's my carrot.
Come on, buddy.
It's delicious.
Come on. You're not even going to wipe the dirt off?
Microorganisms.
This is like a travel-sized carrot.
All right, even though it's November, I'm not growing much. We're gonna go to a guy who grows year round. He understands each step of fall and winter and summer harvesting, and it's amazing, and the guy blows me away. Let's take it to James Prigioni. Hey, James, I appreciate you joining me. I watch your videos all the time, and there's so much information that I feel like every video when I start, I go, I'm about to rock this garden. And then by the end of the video, I'm like, it's too much, I can't do it. But if you had some quick thoughts, what might they be?
It sounds simple, but grow the stuff you like to eat. Like for me, I grow all the, you know, all different kinds of stuff, which is interesting and fun and draws some people in. But when it comes down to it, there's never a strawberry and a blueberry and like an apple or anything that ever goes, that gets inside almost because they just get eaten up immediately. So sometimes when people get into this stuff, they want to try to do immaculate, amazing things. But sometimes it's just easy enough to just grow strawberries, which are easy to grow, but they're delicious too. And then those little things excite you and then kind of continue to move on a little bit. And then you grab a fruit tree.
My neighbor used to have a 6-foot privacy fence. And then he tore it down. So
and
I had
then he saw the show and he said, fuck it, 8-foot fence. Fuck the show.
I don't know if my neighbor would like it, but I want this yard to be a food forest.
I think he'd like it as long as you can manage it nice. A food forest that looks nice, you can't even tell that it's growing food really. So like in a food forest, instead of having something like a big oak tree in a regular forest, we would have a hazelnut tree. And instead of having like poison ivy that's climbing up, we would have grapes that are climbing up. So it's like we look out at the natural forest, we try to mimic and we try to like bring that model and then replace those elements with food. And then that's kind of a food forest.
And I do love to get down in the dirt and just dig around in there. I would dig right here, but I actually have the fall crop coming in. In a matter of months, I'll be eating cabbage.
You want to see a new hour from him? No, fuck that. Hey man, you want to see him rip up on a lane? No. Guys, who wants to see Dusty eat cabbage? Fuck yeah. Wait, in January? Yeah. during this fall crop.
Cabbage rolls, cabbage soup.
Keep going.
Coleslaw.
Walk me through it.
That's about all I know that you can do with cabbage.
What would you say some benefits are of growing your own vegetables?
This first one, simple herbity, the flavor and the taste is like, I mean, you can't even compare like how good the stuff is when you grow it yourself, because a lot of the things they grow in stores, they'll use the basic nutrients of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium. When I grow stuff, I'm using all like the natural things, which have a lot more minerals, which build up a lot of the flavors and stuff. So my things have so much flavor because not only are they grown organically and with all the minerals, but they're also ripened at the peak freshness. So, you know, so whenever they're ripe, you get to taste what real food tastes like. And then I think it, you know, encourages you to grow more because you can tell the stuff in the store. It appears like food and it tastes like food, but it's not as good as it gets. So I think that's one of the really fun things about gardening.
Now I have a new game plan. Next spring, I'm gonna begin to grow things in the house so that when the weather warms up, they come outside, boom, it's gonna be popping.
To hear the excitement in your voice,
yeah,
gets me pumped up. It's like Avengers Endgame, Dusty's ginger root, the new Dune. Like, it's all right there.
Another thing that this show has been about grounding and earthing.
Okay.
They always say that our bodies are like electricity. You know, we're electric beings. Grounding pulls like a lot of negative electricity out of you. Yep. Fills you with positivity.
Do you ground and earth in your backyard?
All the time.
This is what happens when you start making money in show business.
This is what you do. You stand here, you just touch the tree. And then a full cycle.
What's happening here?
Just pulling negativity out of you. I feel very positive right now. Touch the tree, feel that thing. How do you feel? Our next guest, Clint Ober, is the innovator behind the grounding movement and author of Earthing, the Most Important Health Discovery Ever. Hey, Clint, I'm very excited that you're here.
Well, thanks for taking interest. One day I had a computer that was kind of crashing and I knew it was from static electricity. So I figured out a way to ground myself before I would touch the computer, fix the problem. And intuitively, I just asked myself, I said, I wonder if there's any consequence to us humans no longer being naturally grounded. I didn't know, and I went through a process and used my logic from the communications industry that the reason we ground is to prevent charge. When I started grounding myself, my pain went away. I didn't know what it was, didn't know why, didn't understand it at all. So I just pursued that path over 25 years.
Well, that's amazing. And what I like the most is that although very complicated to explain, it's very easy to just do, right? It's very easy to just take your shoes off and walk around in the grass. When I cut the grass, I just cut the grass barefooted.
That's smart. Barefooted. Because as the propeller blade flips shit out and like little rocks and stuff,
yeah,
that's perfect when you don't have shoes on.
I know.
You just honk up your feet.
It's great.
That's a nice run to the emergency room. That's cool.
It is nice when you're walking on rocks or thorns to have that rubber underneath, but you're also, how tough would our feet be if we actually just walked barefooted all the time?
That's true. Your calluses build up quite quickly.
Yeah.
I have heavy calluses on my feet, but I walk at least a mile a day barefoot, sometimes a lot longer.
What do you think a common misconception about grounding is?
All living things on Earth are electrical in nature. So anytime there's an electrical perturbance from an unnatural source or a man-made source, then it's going to perturb electrons in the body, cause them to do something, not necessarily harmful, but it's going to, you know, create anxiety.
Yeah, and whether people believe it or not, it's so simple that it's worth giving a try.
What happens if I'm right?
Right.
Prove me wrong. Do your own experiment, do your own study.
Well, I'm gonna have my mom and dad over for Thanksgiving and I'm gonna make them get out and do that. I think it's gonna be great.
Okay, super.
Well, thank you. I really appreciate what you're doing. I appreciate the documentary and I'm honored that you would come on here and join me. So I really appreciate it.
Well, thanks for the invitation. It's a lot of fun. Appreciate it.
Yeah. All right. Well, take care.
I mean, you think about all the comics that have moved here to Nashville, right? It's you, Kathleen Madigan, Nate Bargatze, Josh Wolf, Angela Johnson, Steve Byrne, Theo Vaughn, John Crist, and I'm the only one that came here to do your show. and you ask me, will I ground? And this, now I know why everybody else turned you down.
Well, to be fair though, you are the only person I ask. Of that big list, you're the first person I ask.
You're too kind. Now I'll fucking do it. What do you want me to do?
Let's ground. Let's earth. Let's connect.
Okay, what do I do?
Doing it right now. All right, this has been Netflix is a Joke, Radio's My Favorite Thing, and I've been your host, Dusty Slay. I'd like to thank all my guests, Clint Ober, Shaye Elliott,
Tiffany Haddish,
James Prigioni, and my friend Steve Byrne. Check out my special on the Stand-Up Season 3, streaming now on Netflix. And Steve, did you have a good time?
I love you. Absolutely.
All right.
Always, buddy.
We're having a good time.
There's a lot of things I'd like to tell you about our friendship. I'm jealous of your hair. You look like an Amber Alert. Did I ever say that to you?
Okay, all right, okay.